Well, hello there. I'm Green Deane, and welcome to my 72nd video here at EatTheWeeds.com. Today, we're going to take a look at a plant that grows near the shore, but don't change this channel because it has relatives that grow inland all across North America, even in deserts.
Before we go out in the field or out along the shore, let's take a good close look at this Seaweed linearis, or the southern Seablite. It's very, very fleshy. Nice, long, thin leaves, pointed on the end. Quite green, and it has branches. The leaves actually alternate. You get the impression that they're opposite, but actually alternate. And it does actually have branches too, that then produce more. And it's in the Chenopodium family, although you'll have to hear some people say Chenopodium, and it makes a very nice pot herb. So let's go take a look at it.
Well, I'm at the beach today, as you can see. But this is not where my plant is found. My plant is found not on the beach side, but way over on the inland water side, on the opposite side of the barrier island. So some of the sea plants you're going to find inland, on the ocean side, and some of them you're going to find on the inland side. And by the way, this plant has a lot of relatives that not only grow down there, but also over in the mainland. So just because you don't live on the beach does not mean that you can't find a relative of this plant near where you live. So let's go take a closer look at it, the sea blight. Here I'm on the barrier island side of the coast here. And here we've got my plant that we're looking at today, sea blight. And let's see, I got several of them here, so let's take a good look at them. You've got this being backlit, but his name is Seaweed linearis, which means Seaweed was what the old Arabic name for it was, and linearis means skinny, and it does very, very skinny leaves. Take a look at this. You can see this leaf is very, very tiny. Not tiny, but thin. And stems are a bit on the pinkish red side. Let's move over to another one. Maybe get a little better light on it. It's growing all along here right now. Here's a nice example right here in the sun. The main branch, it's got some styrations on it. But you can see the leaves are very, 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 very thin. They actually are said to be triangular shaped, but I think that's stretching it a bit. And here's some more of it growing right here rather nicely. Actually, right here is sea purslane, but that's going to be another video at another time. So the fact of the matter is, if I were out here getting food, I got this and I got this here. Nice sea purslane, but we'll do that in a little while. Another video. But here we have, see how nice and frilly this is. Yeah, very nice. And very succulent. And it feels like food. That's an odd thing to say. But you know, we've been around for so long as human beings that when we can sometimes tell by taste or by texture or by feel that this is real food, and this is actually real food. Now, how to use it? Well, you can steam it lightly. You can, it all depends on how much salt you detect in it. Or you can boil it in a couple of changes of water. Or you can just take it as is, chop it up, and make it into your salt seasoning in a salad. Seaweed linearis, also called sea blight. Now, sea blight also has relatives that don't grow anywhere near the sea. This plant thrives where there's salt. So any place inland where you've got a salt lake or a salt pile or even salty roads, you'll find a relative of this plant growing there, and those are called seepweeds. And you'll find them throughout North America and some other places too, or inland, is right down into the middle of the desert. As long as they've got a little water, the salt water there, they'll be growing. So just because you don't live near the ocean, don't think you can't find this plant or its relatives to eat. Sea blight, Seaweed linearis. Just to demonstrate, this doesn't always have to be right on the shore. First of all, if you can see a bit of a ripple out there, that's actually a school of mullet. And this is actually probably the most quiet I've ever seen this inland waterway. But here is an entire stem. Look at this. This is Seablite. This is all Seablite. Get my shadow here. Every bit of it. This is all quite edible. Look at this. I mean, you can also dry this. Use it for future for flavoring soups and stews. So right here, you could actually have enough not only for continuing meals for quite a long time, but also you can prepare yourself for the entire season coming up. There's some seed and some daisies there, but look at that. See, and it's in the same family as some other common things we eat, and it resembles that. It's got a very nice feel to it, good texture. So, excellent example of Suida linearis. Although it's a little hard to tell, we've got some Suida here that's starting to blossom. Little blossoms, look like chinopodium blossoms. Oh, quite tasty. Suida linearis. Seablite.
You know, by the way, you can use the Seablite to stuff fish with, and cook them. And that way it flavors the fish at the same time and also cooks the Seablite. So you don't have to go to much fuss along the seashore to get a well-flavored fish with using the Seablite. Now, here in Eat the Weeds, let's itemize the Seablite and, of course, the Seepweeds. Identification. Well, it's an annual or perennial herb. It grows to about 3 feet high, about a yard high. It's branched, it's succulent, it's light green. Oh, in fact, I have some right here. Nice to show you while I'm talking about it. It has sometimes can have white stems, sometimes pink stalks, depending upon the time of year as it ages. The leaves are very, very narrow. They're pointed. Some people think they're triangular shape. I don't happen to think so, but that's the way it goes. And they're about 2 inches long. The flowers have 5 lobes. And let's see, the seeds are glossy and black. Time of year, late spring to late summer, although it tends to blossom in the summer and fruit in the fall. That's kind of northern climates. Here in Florida, it's kind of around most of the time. Environment. They like salt marshes, beaches, dunes, although I haven't found them on dunes, but I read that they're on dunes. The Seepweeds, they like salt flats, salt lakes, salt piles, salt licks, salty roads. Method preparation. Leaves and stems, and particularly young ones, raw or cooked. You can also just use them as a flavoring, a salt flavoring in other dishes. You can steam these lightly or boil them in several changes of water depending upon how salty they are. The seeds can be made into a mush or ground to be made into a flour, or they can be a flour mixed with other flours. I want to thank you for joining me here in my 72nd video on EatTheWeeds.com. If you want to learn more about the sea blight and the Seepweeds, you can go to EatTheWeeds.com. There I now have, over 400 plants mentioned. So until next time, this is Green Deane. I want you to think green. I want you to eat green and live green, but also this time I really mean eat green, There it is. Makes good pickles, too. Oh, yes. Love it. Toodles.